U-Haul, or at themaine.org. Enjoy the shows.
The following is sponsored programming and does not necessarily reflect the views or opinions of KHTS or its ownership.
Welcome, welcome, Friday, a gorgeous Friday here in the south of France. Where are we today?
South of Newhall.
South of Southern California on KHTS, award-winning KHTS, the Edge Radio Show, the All-American Scott Harries and the coach. I was All-State, and we have a wonderful guest today. On my Facebook, Mr. All-American, I posted from homelessness to becoming a billionaire. But that's not our show today.
No. No.
That's not our show today. No, but that's what I posted on Facebook.
That would be a
From homelessness to a billionaire.
Wouldn't that be something?
Yeah, we're going to be talking about that, but not today. We're going to talk about grieving. You're grieving. I'm grieving. Our guest was grieving, and he did something that very few people in their life, I mean, hundreds and hundreds of millions of people have come through the United States. And this individual did something that very, very few people have ever done in their life. We'll talk about it. Big shout out to my buddy, Jerry Bustrom, and his wife, Joyce. They run our Ventura County fan club. Greg Flowers runs our San Fernando Valley. Bobby Suica runs right here in the beautiful Santa Clarita Valley.
I got to have a shout out to Felicity, Teddy, Harvey, Graham. Teddy, Harvey, and Graham. And Calvin, who is our golfer to be,
maybe in, superstar,
in Las Vegas. Say
now
hi
I
to
already
Dorothy.
Offered you quite a bit of money for him to sign with my agency.
Yeah, we're gonna have to talk about that.
Well, we'll talk about that. Yeah, little Calvin. where does Calvin comes to your house, right?
He comes out all the time this summer. Yeah. Yeah, he's great. Yeah. He's so fun.
I can't wait to meet Teddy, though. I want to meet Teddy, Calvin, the whole group. So someday we'll go back to Minnesota. I've never been to Minnesota.
Yeah, Minnesota's
been
great.
Been to Michigan. Been all Ohio. Had an office in Ohio.
Yeah, Minnesota, you know, that old saying.
It's
not
Minnesota nice anymore.
No, well, it used to be Minnesota nice, and now it's a Minnesota tough. But But it's still where they are in this little town called Eden Prairie, which is out in the suburb of Minneapolis. Very nice place, and I enjoy going there. I really do. Yep, Eden Prairie.
I wish you had a G2, and I'd go with you everywhere.
Oh, so you won't go on my G5. It has to be a G2?
No, G5.
Oh, okay.
No. Well, Brandon and I know somebody that flies a G5 Soarin'.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Soarin'. Brandon, Violet, our wonderful guest. Am I able to say what you do for a living or no?
Please, sure.
Brandon's a Disney writer. He writes for Disney. Did you know that?
Awesome. Yeah, no, I do. Yeah. I remember when we talked to him about
last year, about a program
he was working
you
on.
Before we get into what you did that 99% of the public's never done in their life, and I think it's an incredible accomplishment I want to talk about. But I want to ask you a question. You're 33.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious, in your generation, because that's who you're hanging with, what do they think about what's going on in America? I mean, you know, Scott and I grew up in a different America, and, you know, we're conservatives, and we kind of care about what the founding fathers talked about. We treasure the Constitution. I mean, the Constitution of the United States is the greatest document maybe ever written in the history of man.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's made us the most civilized country in the history of the world.
Yeah.
It's also given us the opportunity to help the rest of the world. People never talk about that.
No, by having the freedoms that we've had over the course of 243 years, it's led to, and the capitalism that came out of it led to the advances that we have technologically.
To help other countries.
Yeah. It's raised the quality of life and the living status of so many people worldwide. It really has. I mean, we can feed the world now, even though there still are places where there's hunger, but we have the ability to feed the world where before we didn't.
Yeah. Scott Harries, coach, the Edge Radio Show, our wonderful guest, Brandon Violet. So in the 30, what do the 30-year-olds think about Kier? I'm really curious.
Yeah, well, I think that if you just boiled it down, it's the people that haven't felt heard want to feel heard. That's really what it is. That's really what it's about. And it's, you know.
That's complicated for me. What did you just say?
They want to make sure their voice is heard.
That's right.
Oh, I thought you said hurt. Heard.
No,
heard.
H-E-A-R-D.
Right.
Heard.
Right.
Oh, they, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, their voices are being heard. Trust me. Mm-hmm. I mean, we get it. Us older dudes get it.
And it's, let me ask you this. Do you think that the people in your generation feel that more needs to, in other words, there needs to be, you know, kind of lids on compensation, things like that, the wealth that can be created by people, so that in order to, it's kind of that socialist model, right, where you take from take from others to give to others, you know. Now we've been doing that for, you know, since World War II era, but it was meant to be temporary, and then it's become, you know, a full-time deal.
Yeah, you know, I don't hear a ton of talk on that. What I hear is really about the social issues.
Mm-hmm.
That's what people seem to be talking about the most.
Right.
And there's a reaction that comes from a lack of consistency in messaging from the government, from above. That's really what it's this kind of whiplash feeling. And so really this need to be heard comes from just a lack of consistency.
Mm-hmm.
So when people are you know, going out there and trying to get themselves heard, being loud, whatever, it's just because they don't feel like there's a consistent dialogue going
on. Here's what Brandon Violet, our wonderful guest on the Edge Radio Show, the All-American Scott Harries and the coach. So where I get confused, look, you're a well-paid a writer for Disney. The people that are out in the street and the people that are breaking windows and causing violence, those are just criminal minds. Those are, but the people that are protesting quietly or intelligently, you know, I don't know who they are. I can't figure out if they love the country. I can't figure out if they want a social system
that's more socialist than nature, that type. That's what I'm with you. I see that. Like I see the, you know, the peaceful protesters, and then you see the others that are, you know, I think just taking advantage of a bad situation.
Well, you and I are very competitive. Now I know
right.
Brandon. He's also right. very competitive. He's as competitive as we are.
Right.
So my question of you is. Mm-hmm. Scott and I and you are where we are because we're very competitive people.
Mm-hmm.
Is your generation as competitive? Are they scratching and fighting and clawing for some form of whatever their own success is?
Yes.
Is that a good question?
Yeah, no, absolutely.
I like to rate my questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I mean, I see, especially in a place like, you know, working where we work in animation, especially in animation, I mean, you know, it's oftentimes it's a meritocracy. I mean, it's, you know, it's really the artists and it's, you know, and the writers and everybody getting their work out there to be seen. And, mm-hmm. and really that's, you know, I mean, that's how you get.
It should
get
be a meritocracy,
yeah.
But I'm just wondering the people that want change. I don't see that.
Right. I don't either. I think that's what sometimes worries me a little bit. And, you know, and so I have kids who are your age and a little bit older, well, 33, so 34 down to 25. And they've been raised in a house, you know, my wife and I kind of think the same way. So so I think that they see things not exactly eye to eye with me, I know that, but I think they see that competitive side. They know that, you know, I'm in a business that's, you know, ultra competitive, and so it's kind of, you know, game on every day type of thing. And so I think they understand that and feel that. So I don't see them leaning a direction where they feel like the government owes them more. But it seems like some of their friends and some of the people that, you know, that they're around have that feeling.
Yeah, I think that there's a perception issue when it comes to social media, and that there's a loud group of people on social media that people looking in from the outside, just like you're talking about, where you don't see them, but that's not everybody.
Right.
That's not everybody. And so I think, I mean, maybe this is just being naive, but I don't know how different, if you want to talk about how scrappy the generations are, I don't know if it's that much of a difference. Sure. I just think it's the perception difference.
Okay. And let me ask you one other question, and just while we're talking about social, you mentioned social media, so I can jump on that for a second. But do you think social media, because you're kind of at that age where it probably just kind of came to light when you were in college, right, to have like a an iPhone, right?
Correct.
05 to 08, somewhere in there, right?
Yeah, I was able to make it through high school with no really smartphone. Yeah.
Right. So you had to learn how to communicate, and, you know, and if you wanted to date someone, you had to talk to them, right? And
pretty much,
right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
So I think there's a real issue with that, because I think that kids today are not learning how to communicate on a one-on-one, face-to-face basis, and it intimidates them when they have to.
Yes, I think that social media and what that does, it distorts your values. Uh-huh. So if you are trying to communicate to get likes or to get attention, that's not the same as communicating in real life to get someone to, you know, it's
to
not
like
the
you.
Same. that value hierarchy, I guess you want to say, is skewed and not for the better. I think with social media, especially when young kids, you know, I mean, that's how their lives are run by.
Right.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting because, I mean, obviously it's proven to be an incredible, you know, money-making machine for sure, because of the advertising model and everything that it does, and getting content out there.
Yeah.
You know, for someone like you, it's a good thing, right? Because there's all kinds of venues. It doesn't have to just be either, you know, TV or cable or the movie theater, right? There's, I don't know, probably hundreds of different venues in which you could get your product out.
Yeah, absolutely. That's why it's a complex issue, because there is so much good that comes with it too.
Right.
But it's like, in terms of the business model, it's like, what's that saying? If a tree that's cut down is worth more than the tree that's standing, you're going to keep cutting down trees.
Right.
And so it's really, the change in values is the end result of the business model. And the business model works really well financially. You know, that's,
right.
I mean, look at, you know,
right.
Facebook is the biggest thing in the history of,
yeah,
you know.
It is, yeah.
But that's what's so tough.
So trees that are cut down are worth more, though. Okay.
I think that's how it goes.
I got some lines, too. How about,
well,
how
no,
about
that's
the day? How about the days are long, but the years go fast?
Yeah.
All right. I want to get into why you're here at KHTS, the Edge Radio Show. So, before we do that, though, I want to say this, that little Calvin, if you're listening, is Calvin listening to the show?
He could very well be, yes.
No, then I'm not going to say anything.
Oh, okay.
When you ran the marathon.
I did.
And I watched it in March.
Yes.
Did you watch it? Did you watch
which one?
The marathon.
LA.
The LA
marathon. LA
marathon.
Yeah. No, I didn't. I didn't actually watch it. No.
So, and something happened during the race, which we'll talk about. But I'm so curious about what it takes to overcome. And we talked about this the other day: spiritual, mental, physical, and emotion. So this goes, our show, The Edge Radio Show, is about helping people get an edge in life, and hoping if just one person's listening to your voice today, maybe they have something they want to accomplish in their life, and they're struggling with it because, you know, a lot of people start, stop. I do that too. You know, I do things I want to do, and then I start, and all of a sudden I stop, and I make excuses, like losing weight. And selfishly, I wanted to have you on because I need to lose about 20 pounds. You know? Yeah. So instead of going to my shrink every week, I'm talking to you.
You can pay me half and we'll talk for half hour.
See, neither of you have bellies, which really ticks me off, okay? You guys don't understand. You have no clue, all right?
No, I used to understand.
Yeah, you never had a belly. You're a basketball player. Yeah. Basketball player, a belly. So when did you start? I mean, how do you all of a sudden wake up one morning and go, I'm going to run the marathon? I mean, what was the process?
Okay, so as you mentioned, I write on a Disney show, and there were a couple of people on the show.
Oh, that Calvin watches, that's what I wanted to say. Mm-hmm. He watches Tots, right?
Tots,
oh, yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, and so there are two people on the show, Travis Brown and Becky Friedman at the time, that have run marathons previously. And so they, after the, not this year's marathon, but last year's marathon, they had finished, Travis had finished and emailed the crew and said, hey, is anyone interested in signing up for the marathon next year? You know, this is the best rate a year ahead of time. And going back to grief, this was at a time when I was kind of in the midst of grieving my uncle, who had passed, I was really close with. And as soon as I saw that, I said, oh, yeah, of course. Even though, for whatever reason, I'd never cared about running a marathon. I never was interested, not at all. But for some reason, this just seemed like a long-term goal, something to aim for that felt healthy and life-affirming, right. I guess, you know, in that sense. And so
you were actually thinking about it. You said yes, and you were actually thinking about it.
Actually, no. That realization came later when I was training and thought, why am I doing this? This is ridiculous. And I looked at the confirmation email that I had gotten a year prior, and I was like, oh, this was – I signed up in March. This was when I was grieving. But, you know, you're in it, so you don't realize you're in it. And then I was like, oh, that's why I'm here. Okay, never mind. I got to do it. I got to finish it, you know. Yeah.
It's interesting. You know, my daughter – Vanessa, who is Calvin's mom, she had a very good friend, her roommate, in fact, when they were freshmen, I believe, at college up at Utah State, and they got to be really, really close, and so now they're in their, you know, it's in the spring semester, and Vanessa had gone out to class and come back, and she came back and found Mercedes was her friend's name, and found her just, you know, kind of stressed. And they started talking, and she says, I'm really worried about my dad. And her dad and mom, you know, were separating, and then her dad had been kind of really depressed. And then all of a sudden the phone rings. And the phone rang, and it was someone from Mercedes' family calling to tell her that her father was gone, that he had committed suicide. And Vanessa was right there watching this whole thing, you know, and she, you know, just held her, and they, you know, she cried, and they worked through this whole thing. Well, fast forward, you know, to I think the next year, they decided to, or Mercedes decided that she was going to run a half marathon to start. And she was up there on an athletic scholarship, believe soccer, and Vanessa decided to join in as a support to her to do it. And Vanessa had, you know, she was a cheerleader and she's a dancer and athlete, but running, never, you know. And she got into this and started to run, and then she ran a half marathon. And then I remember when they were doing it, we all flew up to be there, not only for her but for Mercedes to support her, because we'd gotten pretty close to her. But it was very tearful, because when they crossed that finish line, boy, the emotion that just poured out of Mercedes and everybody else, was everybody there, was it was pretty healing, though, in a lot of ways.
We're going to come back, take a break. I want to go through the race. Literally, I want to start. I want to ask questions like, what time you got there? Do you have to pay to get into the Los Angeles Marathon?
You do.
Yeah.
How much is it?
Oh, depends on when you sign up, but it could be 70 to 100 something.
Okay.
Yeah, in that range.
Okay. Yep. So, all right, we're going to come back. The Edge Radio Show, the All-American Scott Harries and the Coach every Friday at 11 o'clock. We're going to come right back, and we're going to learn about grieving. We're going to learn about how you start from an idea and completely become not only enriched by it, but helping other people too. And hopefully our wonderful guest, Brandon Violette, will help you too. We'll be right back.
There is only one language spoken at Thai Dish, and it sounds something like this.
This is great.
Once people get a taste of Thai dishes, there's really no reason to do any more talking. Make it full of flavor, make it delicious, only at Thai Dishes. Enjoy the atmosphere, love the food. Thai Dishes on Valencia Boulevard for free delivery, 253-FOOD. That's 253-F-O-O-D.
This is Jill from the Santa Clarita Grocery, the all-volunteer grocery program serving children, families, and individuals experiencing food insecurities. Since January 2020, Santa Clarita Grocery has distributed 83 tons of fresh groceries to our 4,655 families in the SCB community. Santa Clarita Grocery is a drive-up, drive-through service with physical distancing in place to continue serving our community. If you are in need or looking for a charity to do the most good for our community, please consider partnering with us by donating to Santa Clarita Grocery, one of the most efficient charities in the Santa Clarita Valley. A full 99 cent out of every dollar goes directly back to the community. Santa Clarita Grocery operates on a 1% overhead and is sustained through private donations. Santa Clarita Grocery is at 21176 Center Point Parkway in the Oasis Furniture parking lot. Please visit our website at santaclaritagrocery.org or our Facebook at Santa Clarita Grocery to make a difference in our awesome town community. 425-7575. Be our guests and experience the difference.
We all know sometimes people lose their way. If you or someone you know is struggling with addiction, The Way Out Recovery SCV may have the answers you've been waiting for. The Way Out is the premier intensive outpatient treatment center serving Santa Clarita. Asking for help is the first step. Call The Way Out today, 661-296-4444. That's 296-4444 for a private, free assessment. The Way Out is an accredited, affordable outpatient program that accepts most insurance. Call us at 661-296-4444 or check us out online at thewayoutrecoverysCV.com. Quit battling with yourself. Ask The Way Out for help today.
Dreaming of becoming the next Steph Curry or Klay Thompson, or maybe just you want your kid to look good and have fun on the court? Introducing the ShotMaster. The ShotMaster is a revolutionary basketball training aid that isolates the shooting pocket, allows you to develop that consistent shot. ShotMaster will improve your shooting efficiency, accuracy, and shooting percentages dramatically. It's the ultimate training device. There's nothing like it. Visit ShotMaster.net and discover for yourself how ShotMaster will become your game changer. ShotMaster.net.
I listen to it all day, every day.
Hometown, your hometown station.
Welcome back. Welcome back. The Edge Radio Show every Friday from 11 to 12. Our wonderful guest today, Brandon Violette. He's a Disney writer, and he did something that we are going to share with you now. He ran a marathon last March, and he ran it for a couple of reasons. And the first reason was you wanted to really, I think, dedicate the running to Sean, your uncle who passed away, right?
That's right. Sean Gallagher, Uncle Sean.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you still think about him.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So grieving, both Scott Harries and I lost a friend about a month ago, Lance.
Yeah.
And I still think about him. Mm-hmm. Every time I talk to him, he encouraged me. He was so positive. He had cancer, and he never whined to me.
Nope. No, he never did to me either. And, you know, Lance and I founded ShotMaster together and worked together, and we'd known each other since we were 16 years of you know, 16 years yeah. old at basketball camps, and he was just, you know, always in shape. And, you know, I mean, the guy's going to chemotherapy, and, you know, I know people that did, you know, that have gone through that, and all they want to do is go home and crawl into bed. And he'd go home and, you know, and he'd get on a bike and go ride for 10 miles, you know. I mean, that's just the kinds of things he did. He was just so upbeat and loved life. And
grieving is such an individual thing. I lost a friend 2 weeks ago, went in to UCLA, had a pain in his stomach, make a long story short. It was stage 4 pancreatic cancer, and a week later, boom, gone. So you dedicate
running in the marathon, Deshaun. What? First of all, the race start. I watch it. The race starts at what? 7 a.m.
Yeah, I want to say 6-7 o'clock.
What
in
time
the
do you get there?
Oh, you get there. I mean, you get there at, you know, at least 5 a.m.
Okay, it's dark.
Yeah. Oh, it's dark when you begin. Yeah.
Now, what's this carbo load? Did you do any carbo loading the night before?
Actually, I did. I read that white bread was better than wheat bread just because of the way your body mm-hmm. absorbs it. And so it was a peanut butter and jelly like the night before.
That was it?
That
just
was
one sandwich?
The night before, yeah. And then when you wake up.
Just one sandwich?
Well, I mean, you eat the whole day, but right before you go to bed,
right.
That's what you have. Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah, it used to be.
Yeah.
We used to do pasta and stuff.
Yeah, pasta.
When I was, yeah, mm-hmm. pastas when yeah. I was playing basketball.
Training table.
Dinners.
Our training table.
Table
yeah.
Stuff,
yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so you're there at 5 a.m. Mm-hmm. Are you nervous? Is there a, like, Scott was an All-American basketball player. I was an All-State football player. I would get so anxious right before the game, like a half an hour before the game. I'm going, oh, my God, I don't know if I can do this again. You know,
yes.
And I've been doing it
yeah.
all through high school.
Sure.
And
yeah.
Were you that anxious? Or
yes. It's always the worst right before you start something.
Mm-hmm.
It always is, you
yeah.
know. And then, but the especially in a marathon, because it's all about just endurance, just finishing. You're not trying to win. You're trying to just
finish.
And survive. And so the beginning, when you start, it's really just about being calm and being relaxed.
Mm. Right.
Because you're going to, you know, you're excited and you're adrenaline, but you don't want to listen to all the music that's going to make you go faster because you're not going to have that energy at the end.
Yeah.
So
you're trying to stay calm so your body doesn't burn up excess energy that you're trying
right.
to store, right?
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
Tip one, be
yeah.
calm. Okay,
be calm.
I like that.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually listened to classical music in the beginning. Because I didn't
want to
listen, you know, rock
yeah.
music.
Oh, you have a headset?
I had, I had my
your
AirPods.
Your playlist.
Right. Yeah.
So wait, so that's, how many miles is it again?
26.2.
And can we ask out, what time did you do it in?
4:57. So just under 5 hours.
That's pretty good for the first time.
It's okay. I didn't
yeah.
die.
Yeah. So
it would take me about 4 days.
Yeah.
maybe 5 days.
Yeah.
As long as you finish, it doesn't matter. Just finish.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there are people that.
Well, I'd show up and they'd be sweeping, you know, like the lights are down.
That's right. Like,
okay,
doesn't
so where are you? So there's 20,000 people. Where are you in that group? You're not in the front because that's where the elite runners
certainly
are.
Certainly right? not. I'm closer to the back.
You are?
Yeah. I mean, there's still, you know, yeah, but there's always people around you. That's
mm-hmm.
the thing. You're not. You know, there's always
and you're
people
talking to them.
You.
You're friendly.
Friendly, but you're not really talking. No,
got
you're focused.
Okay.
And they're but the thing. That
okay,
was,
the race starts. Boom.
Yeah.
The race starts. Now what happens?
Well, now you remember your strategy. So this was something I had to learn.
You
from
had a
the,
strategy.
The people that have done it before, which was you have to know how fast you're going to run for
right.
how long.
Mm.
So roughly, it was something like 2 to 4 minutes of jogging, and then 30 seconds of walking. 2 to 4 minutes, and even
oh.
and you should walk even when you don't feel like
gotcha.
You need to walk
gotcha.
Because it's all about conserving your energy. And along the way, there are water stations, Gatorade stations. You take water, you take Gatorade when they give it to you, even if you don't need it, because that's part of that electrolyte loading
Got
that's
going
to help you at the end.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
So I would do the opposite. I would walk for like 5 minutes and then jog for 30 seconds. I wonder how long it would take me to do
well,
the race.
At the end, that's kind of how it is.
Okay.
You know, you're walking a little longer, but you try to
See,
go.
I'm afraid that if I did that, the battery on my golf cart would run out. And so I wouldn't make
right.
it at all.
Wouldn't that be funny? That'd be funny. Scott Harries in his golf cart. Oh,
extra
man.
Charge.
Oh,
right.
I can see that
yeah.
where Lisa's driving the cart.
Yeah,
and
I'd get out and run for a little
yeah.
bit. Then I'd jump in and we'd ride for 5 or 6 miles.
Oh.
And I'd run for a half a mile. And then
okay, so mile one, what are you thinking? What the first mile? What do you think? This you're probably thinking, this is easy, right?
Well, yeah, there was someone dressed as Elvis that was running in the race, and he just shouted, "Are we there yet?" And everyone laughed, and it was like, okay, remember that this is fun. Like,
yeah.
I mean, it's a weird idea of fun, but you're here voluntarily. Don't take it too seriously. Like, just focus. And so mile one, actually, you know, it was dark when we started. That was the sunrise. So you're starting at Dodger Stadium. downtown LA, you're running, and then you look, at, you know, it was to my left, and there was the sunrise. And it was like,
this is nice. I could,
Yeah.
Maybe I should run the race with you and just go like a mile.
Whatever you can do, just start.
So, you know, I'm such a nitwit. I'm more concerned about how did you get back to your car? You know, you're 27 miles away. How do you get back to your car?
Family at the end. And then they drive you. Yeah.
Is that most people? Right. Yeah, or Uber. Or Uber,
but there's so much traffic, family.
Okay, so you're running, you got Elvis. And I knew Elvis is out there. I know Elvis is out there. So, okay, mile three, four, five, what's going on emotionally, intellectually, mentally, spiritually?
You just try to focus on, you know, at least what I was doing was I was seeing parts of the city I had never seen before. This is still, you're still adrenalized. This is still the beginning. Everyone's still
going.
Where
did the race start?
It started at Dodger Stadium.
Oh.
So you're going through, you know, Little Tokyo, Chinatown, and all the way, you're ending up in Santa Monica. Yeah, yeah.
Dodger Stadium up on a hill. Are you running downhill the first mile, I guess?
A little, it's a little uneven. You're running down, up, yeah. Mm-hmm. Sometimes straight away. Mm. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Because obviously you're on the street.
Right.
Okay.
Yep. But they say that mile 17 to 19 is the hardest.
Yeah.
And that's when
people.
Yeah, that's the
killer. That's where you remember that old terminology in when we did track and field, right? It's like on that third corner going around, you know, if they were doing the 440 where the bear, you know, be careful, the bear jumps on your back, you know.
Right.
I was a 440 runner.
Right. That's where the bear gets you, right? It's mile 17. Yeah.
This is why you take all the Gatorade and water in the beginning, because this is when you need it. This is when you go to your rock music. There's no more classical. You know, this is when you really pump it, because now you're just trying to finish.
Now you're on adrenaline.
Yes. Yeah.
So so even around mile 10, you have energy?
Still. Yep.
Oh, wow.
Yep. Yep.
And then it just what the All-American said, it hits you at 17?
Yeah, 17 to 19, because it's a big accomplishment to go that far, but it's, you know, it's like two-thirds. You know, you still got a chunk left.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So you have to stay in the game.
Were you out of gas mentally or physically? I mean, what did it feel like?
Well, there was something interesting that kind of happened around mile 19, actually. It was I was starting to get a little emotional, because I was thinking about my, you know, I was thinking about my uncle and kind of why I was there, and it was just like, and I was,
you were dedicating the race to him.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. And that was when I really felt just like I was really thinking about him, you know, intensely. Yeah. And so I was starting to get emotional, and I was, you know, I had sunglasses on, I was sweating, so I thought, you know, if I get emotional, no one will tell, it just looks like sweat. But I was going, and I thought, you know, this is just kind of crazy why I'm even here. Mm-hmm. And so I'm you know, kind of emotional, thinking ahead. I look and I see the next mile marker. So I was around mile 19. I looked, I said, okay, that must be 20. I'm 26 miles, I'm almost there, I gotta, you know. And then I get closer to it, and it's mile 21.
Wow.
So I had gone a whole mile without realizing it, and suddenly I was like, okay, 26, that's nothing. You know, I'm way further ahead than I thought. I can finish this, bring it together, you know, and finish. But so all along the race, because you have your number, and there's plenty of apps where people can track you, and they can see, okay, you know, he's on mile 2, 3, 4, 5. So I finished the race, and I call my family, and I'm like, hey, I finished, you know. And they're like, are you okay? I said, yeah, why? Well, you fell off the tracker at mile 19. And I said, oh, that's kind of weird. Like, that's right when I went a mile without realizing it, and was talking to my uncle, and, you know, and it's like, oh, okay, that's kind of odd. And then my dad had pointed out that mile 19 was Century City, and that was where my uncle's old office was.
Mm.
And so it was like, okay, like, this race is really all about him, and just getting to that finish. And it was like, I don't know, you know, it could be a series of coincidences, but I think that's just a poetic.
Have you ever?
That's when he was carrying you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting.
He was right there, pushing you along.
That's
interesting comment. He was carrying you. But either one of you ever, like, driven in your car and then 10 minutes later go, where have I?
Right.
What is the same thing happened to you? I mean, yeah. I don't know what that's called. I have no idea.
Has that
ever happened to you, Patty, where you've driven along and then 10 minutes later you're going, how did I get here?
I don't think so.
No, I
maybe.
I definitely have had those.
This young lady says yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm just trying to think what it's called, because that's what happened to you.
Right.
Yeah, it's either a zoning out, or it's a hyper focus, or it's a, you know, because you're not aware of everything, but you're aware of one or two things intensely.
Right.
You know, and that's really what it is. And so,
So he cared, just what Scott said, he literally carried you for a couple of miles.
It's
so
that's
now
funny though that the marker went off. You know,
that's the weird thing.
That's, yeah.
That's very weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you still have energy.
Yes.
Do you eat protein bars or any? Are you eating anything at all during these 5 hours?
You don't eat protein. Some people can. It's different for everyone.
Yeah.
But what I was taking was something called runner's goo, where it's and it's basically just, you know, it's sugar, it's electrolytes, it's what you need, you know, and you take it every couple miles.
Wow.
There's also some.
I tried that before.
You know what is actually a good thing to do? Around mile 19 or so, Advil. Take a couple of Advil because your joints are swelling.
So
you know,
bad,
you need to.
Do people
to,
do that?
Yeah, I did. You know, just to kind of I need to make sure I don't like buckle up and stop.
A lot of stuff going on.
Reduce
in this
inflammation.
Race. You
no, there's a whole science around getting through this. I have a buddy who, my neighbor, who's an attorney, and he's done marathons and things, but he does those 100-mile, you know, races across the desert kind of thing. Those just crazy ones. And it's funny because, you know, like all the planning that you were talking about, like they have all this kind of planning, and he would plan to eat certain things. And then over time, he figures out what helps him. And basically, he literally, you know, after he ran, because you run day and night, right? And you get delirious. You know, he says you literally get delirious. And you got someone kind of checking on you every so often. But he said he got to the point where, you know, like the Gatorades and all that stuff, all at certain points was just making him sick, right? And over, so he got rid of it, and he started just eating Ritz crackers and Coke. And literally, that's what take. So the first, like, 75 miles was, you know, kind of the normal stuff. And then the last, you know, 25 miles was just, you know, things like that. Just because he was just fighting being so sick, you know, from.
What is it about a Ritz cracker? I love them.
I do,
I mean,
too.
It's
the
weird.
Salt.
Yeah.
The salt.
Is
I guess.
That
yeah.
what it is?
Yeah.
So now you finish the race. We're talking to our wonderful guest, Brandon Violette, who ran the marathon. And the Edge radio show is what you're listening to. It's free. We should be charging you, but we're not. right?
That's right.
free. On 98.1 FM and 1220 AM. The best radio app in the country. Just go to the App Store and download KHTS 1220. It's really, you could take the whole KHTS with you, and we have great shows every hour of the day. Now, you cross the line. What does that feel like?
Oh.
Does that feel like winning the Super Bowl? I mean, it's got to be one of the great triumphs of your life.
Yeah, it what you're so grateful for, just the people that you don't know along the sides that cheer you on.
Mm-hmm.
It's a feeling of, oh, this is like a community. Mm. Like people that I don't know, that I'll never see again, that looked at me, you know, while I was one of the many runners passing them and saying, keep going, you're almost there. And it's like, wow, that you actually take from that, and it's
the
fuel.
Yeah.
You know?
The adulation. I mean, we as adults, who cheers for us?
Right.
Except my dog, little Lexi Lulu, right?
Right.
Do you have a dog, Scott?
Yeah, Goose.
So when you come home, does Goose go crazy?
No, Goose and I do not have a good relationship.
Oh God, this is Patty's another show. Something's not right with the all-American. What kind of dog is Goose?
Goose is a purebred Vizsla.
Okay.
It's a bird hunting
Patty,
dog.
get the shrink on the line. We've got an issue here. So,
yeah,
okay,
we got
so,
problems.
Oh, yeah. So the people are applauding. I can see that. So you cross the line, and you it sounds like you just are full of gratitude.
Yes, you absolutely are, and I couldn't stop. I definitely stopped running, but I couldn't stop walking. I had to just keep walking because my leg, you know.
It would cramp up, right?
So I had to keep going and keep going. Yeah.
I was just told to be nice to Goose.
Is that Lisa?
No, it's Maddie.
Madeline, I miss
Maddie.
You.
Madeline, well, I miss Maddie back on the show.
We've got to come in, Madeline, and we got to find out how your dad, one of the nicest men I've ever, I'm his only friend, incidentally, how him and Goose could have an issue. It doesn't make sense.
It's very complicated.
Okay, so you have to keep walking. I get that. I mean, all athletes, we have to keep walking so you don't cramp up and blah, blah, blah. And then, so a half an hour after the race, where are you now, half an hour after the race? You got a medal, right?
Got a medal.
Can you bring the medal next time? Can you bring the medal Monday when we play gin?
Sure, yeah.
I want to see the medal.
Well, yeah.
You need gin lessons, too. You're funny. So a half an hour, the race is over. Where are you now?
He's in a bar throwing down. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Tempting. That's what you want to do. I'm meeting up with my family and coworkers. So we're at a hotel down the street, and we're all getting together.
Are you
eating?
Are you
pizza? Yeah,
pizza. Gotcha.
Get those carbs back. All. Yep.
Did you lose weight?
It certainly felt like it. Yeah. But then,
Water weight. I mean, I know guys. I don't know.
I'm really asking dumb questions, aren't I?
No. I mean, they're interesting. I think they're interesting because as an athlete, like, you know, after a game, I'd end up losing 10, 15 pounds.
And you can't afford it. I know. We'll be right back. The Edge Radio Show. We'll finish up with our wonderful guest, Brandon Violette, talking about running the marathon. And the reason I have a question that you might find interesting. We'll be right back.
If you'd like to take your business up a notch, take a look at Elite Magazine.
Linda and Mo Hafizi, owners of our Valley's two leading magazines, the Magazine of Santa Clarita and Elite.
I'm so proud of Elite. It allows your advertisement to stand out. We distribute Elite to 50,000 homes and businesses. You'll find us in 1,900 local hotel rooms.
Discover how Elite Magazine can help your business. Call 294-4444.
Superior quality is second nature to us. Just ask our advertisers.
Hi, I'm Steve Cruz, and my wife and I own the local pub and grill. With 19 70-inch TVs, it's the best place in the Valley to catch a game. We have a vast selection of beer, wine, and specialty cocktails to choose from, including our charity ale, where 10% of every pint we sell goes to Carousel Ranch. Our menu features classics with a flavorful twist. Come by for Taco Trivia Tuesdays at 7, Wednesday for bingo and karaoke starting at 8 p.m., and karaoke every Saturday at 9. Local pub and grill, right next to BevMo on the old road. Support local, support community.
Introducing Oakmont of Valencia, Oakmont's second luxury senior living community in Santa Clarita. At Oakmont of Valencia, you'll have access to full-time assisted living services provided by compassionate staff in the privacy of your own home. Oakmont's diabetic wellness program offers assistance with monitoring and managing glucose levels, meals, exercise, and activities. Oakmont of Valencia offers a fully equipped wellness center and concierge medical program, allowing outside physicians to visit on site. Discover the care your loved ones deserve in a resort-style setting. Visit oakmontofvalencia.com.
Dreaming of becoming the next Steph Curry or Klay Thompson, or maybe just you want your kid to look good and have fun on the court? Introducing the ShotMaster. The ShotMaster is a revolutionary basketball training aid that isolates the shooting pocket, allows you to develop that consistent shot. ShotMaster will improve your shooting efficiency, accuracy, and shooting percentages dramatically. It's the ultimate training device. There's nothing like it. Visit ShotMaster.net and discover for yourself how ShotMaster will become your game changer. ShotMaster.net.
It's like no other station I've ever listened to. It's great.
Your hometown station.
Back. We're back. The Edge Radio Show, the All-American Scott Harries and a coach, a wonderful guest, Brandon Violette. You can listen on 98.1. I think a lot of people just listen on hometownstation.com. Hometownstation.com, the most popular website in all of Santa Clarita, Palmdale, Lancaster, Fillmore, Santa Paula, and the San Fernando Valley. So, Brandon, it seems to me that an accomplishment like this, which I could never do, finishing 27.4 miles, do you use that as a foundation for accomplishing other things? How often, seriously, does it come into your thought that you did this?
Well, I still, now, I run pretty regularly just for, I hesitate to say, enjoyment. I mean, I really like it now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so I think of it every time I do that because it's changed my life after in what I do.
Did you feel that endorphin rush at some point?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
See, I've never been able to run long enough to feel it. I'm hurting too bad. I'm sorry, but I just, even when I was a kid, I did.
We're linemen. Look at the size of us. Come on, man.
My knees would be going, oh, well, you know, barking. Ow, 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 go home. I'm sorry.
Sorry, Goose.
So how do you use this now for other things?
Yeah, I think that motivation matters. I mean, when you want to do anything, it's understanding the motivation of why you're there in the first place. Right. So it's like what we were just talking about. If you have a why, you can bear any how.
So you need a why, okay.
Yeah, and I forget where that originated from, but it's, you know.
Oh, Tim's listening. He says it's not 27.4 miles.
Yeah. 26.
What is it?
2.
Sorry, 26. Tim.
26.2.
Yeah,
sorry, Tim. What is
thank
it?
You. I was going to let that go. Yeah. 26.2.
I didn't want to correct you.
26.2. Sorry, Tim.
Well, you made me look better, so I'll take it.
So 26.2.
Yes.
If you have a why, you can withstand.
Okay.
You can bear any how.
Anyhow.
And that's really, and that just comes down to the motivation and really understanding why it is that you're doing it in the first place.
This is good stuff.
Yeah. Like that.
So you need a why, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What's the real motivation, the real purpose? And then with that, you feel like you can then bear anything. And I mean, you can break that down to some of the simplest things of I'm trying to provide for my family and I'm it and I got to do it, right? To something more emotional that, hey, you know, my uncle was the best to me and, you know, and taken from me, you know, in an inopportune time. And now you're doing something to, you know, to validate him in a way in your life. And you're doing something very hard and challenging. And so it's there's a lot of those good things, you know, that drive us, hopefully. In life.
So you need a why. That makes sense to get to the how. So right. I'm trying to lose weight so I can figure out the why.
I'll tell you the why.
Yeah.
The why is you want to be healthy and
right.
you want to be present for those grandkids.
Right.
And
so how do I get to the how?
So now you got to work on the how.
Interesting.
You know, and on the right. But now that why, I mean, for me, that's one of those. You know, I use that why for my kids and my
weight. You look good.
No, but just to, you know, for other things that I want to, that I need to, you know, focus on and be better at and take, you know, take better care of myself and things like that. So,
yeah. Well, turn off your phone, which we're both starting to do.
Yeah.
If you haven't watched social media on Netflix,
Social Dilemma.
Social Dilemma.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, watch Social Dilemma.
Yeah, we
Netflix,
should do a whole show on that. We should. It's really important. I don't know. Who would we get in to do that show? We need to find. Can you help us?
We can find someone that can talk.
Yeah, because it's people don't realize, and I don't want to end the show like this, so I'll stop. But we don't realize we're being manipulated. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, all right, back to the marathon. So you do use it as a wonderful vehicle to help you in other areas of your life.
Sure. And I think that it just goes back to that motivation. Matters. It
gives
that,
you motivation.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's, it's tackling fuel, right? Mm. From Waterboy. You ever seen Waterboy? You got to watch Waterboy. Tackling fuel. In other words, it was like the same thing. It's the why.
Uh huh.
You know, it's the, you know.
No,
the
show helped
me
today because I'm going to be thinking about, I think I know the why. I'm just struggling with the how.
Right. I think we all do, and I think that's with everybody. Sometimes we have the why, and we start, and we can't keep it going, and we've got to find what it is that short circuits that why in order to be disciplined enough to keep going. So those are the things.
You're nailing it. Thank you for saying that, because what kept you going was Sean.
That's right.
Yes.
And something that you said that made me, you were talking about coaches why as grandkids.
Right.
And that's just something outside of yourself.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, my uncle, that's outside of myself.
Right. That's right. So serving someone else, being there for someone else.
Yeah.
Great
thank
show.
You for today. Thank you. Thank you both, really.
Thank you
both.
Okay.
See you next week, the Edge Radio Show. Thank you.